Big thank you to those that support me on Patreon for making this video possible. It was an absolute pleasure to reread all of Brienne's point of view chapters and all the chapters that she was in. Your support allows me to spend time combing the books for character details that provide a deeper history of a character than the wikis could ever provide due to their nature, providing quick and basic information that sometimes, unfortunately, is wrong. If you would like to help the channel, link to my Patreon in the video description down below. Thank you again. Brienne Tarth, commonly called Brienne of Tarth, but also known as Brienne the Blue, the Maid of Tarth, and Brienne the Beauty, is the second-born child of Lord Selwyn the Evenstar, born in 280 AC into House Tarth at Evenfall Hall, located on the island of Tarth, which lies in the Stormlands. While some may consider Tarth a ghastly rock or dreary mountain in the Narrow Sea, it is called the Sapphire Isle for the blues of its water, and while many others may consider it beautiful, most importantly, Brienne does. She had one older brother named Galadon, but tragically he drowned when she was 4 and he was 8. Though two sisters would follow after her birth, Alysanne and Arianne, they both died in the cradle, leaving Brienne an only child by the age of 4. If that wasn't depressing enough, Brienne's mother also died before she was old enough to remember her. The burden of being an only child and essentially a two-unit family with her mother and siblings gone would weigh on Brienne, with her believing she was the only child that gods would let her father keep, the freakish one not fit to be a son or daughter. She would think that he deserved a daughter that could sing to him and grace his halls and bear sons, and he deserved a strong and gallant son to bring honor to his name, not her. Sometimes she would even slip up and call herself her father's son. If the burden of being the only child wasn't enough, Brienne's life was made incredibly hard due to her looks as well. It became apparent quickly as the girl grew rapidly that she wasn't going to be a beauty, at least not by the Seven Kingdoms standards. In fact, upon meeting her in the books, Catelyn Stark thought, "Is there any creature on earth as unfortunate as an ugly woman?" And though Catelyn was a very judgmental woman, she wasn't the only one that remarked on Brienne's ugliness. Many called her ugly, and even with attractive lands and wealth to go with a betrothal, if you're an ugly woman, that may not be enough, as I'll talk about later in this video. So let's talk about how Brienne is described in the books, because in the show, Brienne's actress is absolutely gorgeous, and you don't get a real sense of just how bad it was. If she had been born a man, she would have been called big, reaching around 6.5 feet, like Robert Baratheon. But being a woman, she is considered freakishly huge. Not only is she tall, but she had broad shoulders, she learned to hunch, with a chest more muscle than bosom, that even as an adult woman, would look more natural on a 10-year-old. She had even broader hips, long legs with enormous feet, and thick arms with big hands. Even her face is broad and coarse, with a wide, flat, horsey face, prominent teeth, or horse teeth as some would call them, that were crooked, a mouth too wide that had lips so plump they appeared swollen, and thin, limp hair that looked like a squirrel's nest of dirty straw. 1,000 freckles are sprinkled across her brow and cheeks, and through events we'll talk about in a bit, it was evident that she had her nose broken a few times. So not very ladylike if you ask those of the Seven Kingdoms. Well, most of the Seven Kingdoms. I can think of a few that might find that a major turn-on. Some consider her uglier when wet, and are surprised that that is even possible. However, there was something that many couldn't deny was beautiful physically about her. Her eyes. Brienne's eyes are large and very, very blue. Even Jaime Lannister considers them the only part of her truly beautiful, which is a major compliment from him. But he also believes they are eyes of an innocent young girl. He'd also note that she had shoulders and a neck that were thicker than his own. Oh, and he felt a scowl fit her broad, homely face better than a smile, and you'd be better off dressing a cow in silk than her, believing she always looked more man than woman. So, just all around a charming guy. Because of how she looked, she would have quite a few problems growing up, and as an adult, and eventually earned the nickname Brienne the Beauty. That nickname was typically not said to her face as an adult, however, unless the person wanted to defend those mocking words with their body. She became accustomed to disapproving, mocking, and pitiful looks as a little girl, and quickly learned women were just as cruel to her as men. However, she could never decide what was worse. the stinging tongues and brittle laughter of pretty girls, or the cold-eyed ladies who hid their disdain behind a mask of courtesy. She did know common women could be worse than both of them, lacking the etiquette to not ask her if she had a cock or a cunt. You can imagine for a girl and then young woman, her treatment through her life had a huge impact on her. As Catelyn Stark would note by the time of the books, the walls around her were higher than that of Winterfell's. So afraid of mocking looks and laughter that made her already shy nature even worse, as a little girl and then adult, she doesn't allow herself to bond or become a part of anything. Though I want to note for a while, those trying to win favor with her father would actually treat her nicely, which for a time, she believed those words. So it wasn't like she had nasty comments thrown at her from birth. It was a septa that would ground her in reality. Being the only surviving child of Lord Tarth, that made Brienne one of the few ways to get into his good graces. Her father's men would tell her she was a pretty girl, and that she was tall, clever, bright, and danced gracefully, but it was her septa that let her know their lies, telling her they only said those things to win her father's favor, and that she could see the truth of how she looked in her mirror, not with what men said. While this seems like a cruel thing to say to a child and had made her cry, it also taught her to be mistrustful and think critically about the words of others and why they might be saying something. However, the septa may have gone too far as she reminded Brienne that she was mannish, freakish big, and a slow child over and over. As a small child, her nurse told her tales of Valor, telling the noble exploits of Sir Galadon of Morn, Florian the Fool, Aemon the Dragon Knight, and other champions. Through these tales and the singers that came to court, she learned when a knight dies in battle, they sing about them. She also noticed when a woman dies in childbed, no one sings songs about them. These tales made her believe no promise was as serious as one sworn to the dead, and these stories of knights would stay with her, and she believed in the chivalry of knights, even as she experienced the exact opposite. Except hedge knights, who she thought had an unsavory reputation and no different from robber knights, them being two sides of the same sword. Being obsessed with stories of brave knights likely pushed Brienne one day to ask Sir Goodwin, the mastered arms of Evenfall, to teach her the sword. Brienne had strong notions of being a knight. To her, knights never saw winter. If they were to die in battle, they would be sung about, and it is always summer in songs. In songs, all knights are gallant, all maids are beautiful, and the sun is always shining. But that wasn't the only reason she wanted to learn the sword. Fighting gave her a sense of purpose and control. She couldn't fix how she looked and how others reacted to her appearance. But she didn't feel helpless when fighting. With a sword, a horse, and sometimes an axe, you were in control. And when armored, it was hard for anyone to hurt you. Though the man agreed to teach her, he did warn her that every knight has battle scars, and asked her if that was what she wanted. When she said yes, and while she received a knight's equivalent training, he would question her often if she was hard enough for battle, telling her many times, "You have a man's strength in your arms, but your heart is as soft as any maid's. It is one thing to train in the yard with a blunted sword in hand, and another to drive a foot of a sharpened steel into a man's gut and see the light go out in his eyes." To toughen her up, he had sent her to her father's butcher to slaughter lambs and piglets. She remembered the piglets squealing and the lambs screaming like frightened children, and by the time she was done, Brienne had been blind with tears and soaked in blood. So badly was she soaked in blood, her maid had to burn her clothing. But being able to slaughter animals wasn't good enough for her master at arms. He told her, "A piglet is a piglet. It is different with a man. When I was a squire young as you, I had a friend who was strong and quick and agile, a champion in the yard. We all knew that one day he would be a splendid knight. Then war came to the Stepstones. I saw my friend drive his foeman to his knees and knock the axe from his hand. But when he might have finished, he held back for half a heartbeat. In battle, half a heartbeat is a lifetime. The man slipped out his dirk and found a chink in my friend's armor. His strength, his speed, his valor, all his hard-won skill, it was worth less than a mummer's fart, because he flinched from killing. Remember that, girl." And although this is cheating because this happens during the time of the books, you'll be happy to know that when the time came as an adult, she didn't flinch or hesitate to kill. Through her training, she would become as strong as most knights, and her master at arms would tell her she was quicker than any woman her size had right to be. Not only that, but Brienne developed stamina, which Goodwin deemed a noble gift, sharing with her that fighting with a sword and shield was wearisome, and victory often came to the man that had the most endurance. But Goodwin didn't just teach her how he'd teach any boy. Instead, he trained her to fight with caution and conserve her strength, and to let her foes wear themselves out with furious attacks, telling her, "Men will always underestimate you, and their pride will make them want to vanquish you quickly, lest it be said that a woman tried them sorely." He often cautioned her, "Wait and watch, girl. Wait and watch." Advice that would serve her well. As her training continued, she would have armor made for her. Steel that was a deep, brilliant blue cobalt. She'd often wear a velvet doublet that was quartered rose and blue. Pants and boots with a fine-tooled sword belt. Her horse would wear the quartered sun and moon of House Tarth. All this hard work and training, while accentuating her already mannish-looking body, gave her calves like cords of wood and long, strong muscles in her arms that made it so she could row half a night and show no signs of tiring, even when other men would. It gave her strength that when trying to subdue her, it would take at least 4 men to beat her into submission, with some claiming she was as strong as Gregor Clegane, though that's likely not true. Though she received all this training and was just as good as others who had become knights, she would never, as of the last book, receive the honor of becoming one herself. Besides her training, before she learned to ride a horse, she learned to manage oars, which makes sense as Tarth is an island. She also happens to be a fantastic diver and swimmer, though she did learn to ride and care for horses, including how to brush out their coats and pull stones from their shoes. She also became skilled in cooking, cleaning game, and hunting as well as any man. But I've talked a lot about her looks and training. Besides her physical appearance, it is noted by many that she is pighead stubborn, lacks the wits to be a liar, but is loyal past the point of sense, and incredibly honest. Though very shy and only becoming more shy as she was bullied and made fun of, she was always polite and performed her duties with little complaint. However, the shyness and mockery made it so she wasn't one to chatter, laugh, or cry, considering herself not made for revel. Though she didn't often drink wine, she would occasionally drink down watered wine to ease her stomach. So now let's talk about her growing up at Evenfall and the disaster of her betrothals. Despite her appearance and the mockery that came with it, Brienne had a mostly good childhood. She felt safe at Evenfall and in the tall arched windows of her father's hall, and would spend her time as a young girl playing around her father's feet. She knew even as an adult that she could come home to her father at any time and be welcomed and safe. As long as Brienne can remember, there was always a singer at Evenfall Hall, and she learned all the songs by heart. She remembers a woman with eyes the color of plums and a tiny waist coming from across the narrow sea, singing in a language she didn't know, in a voice as lovely as the woman's appearance. However, despite knowing the songs, Brienne never sang for her father, though she had wished she had. Brienne also remembers her father bringing a new woman to her home every year, but later in life learned those weren't really ladies and something else. At least her father found a way to curb his loneliness with the loss of his wife. Having free reign of her home, she would spend time in her father's cool and dark armory. She took note of Sir Duncan the Tall Shield, who is her blood relation, and would run her hands along the painted tree and falling star. She also had a fine education and access to as much knowledge as she wanted. She learned from at least a Septa, a Septon, and a Maester. Her father Septon told her repeatedly that there was but one god with 7 aspects. Her Septa taught her that holy men shave the top of their head to show they had nothing to hide from the father. Brienne had asked if the father couldn't see through hair, which she was made to feel stupid for asking. Her maester taught her many things, including that the defiance of Duskendale had driven King Aerys mad. During her learning, she read somewhere that all men were brothers on the Gallow Tree. She of course learned much more, but we'll have to wait for more Brienne point of view chapters to get more information. I'd say one of the saddest things about Brienne was the outcome of her betrothals and how they scarred her for life. Growing up, her father would make a match with three men to marry her off. As Brienne was Lord Tarth's only child and would inherit Evenfall and the Isle of Tarth, it was especially important for him to find a good match for her. Even with the attractive land and wealth that came with Brienne, the betrothals were all a disaster. The first time she was betrothed was at the age of 7 to a younger son of Lord Brian Caron. The boy she was matched with was 10 at the time and had been shy like Brienne. The two children met each other for the betrothal, and they were expected to marry within the year she flowered. But because life didn't want to make it easy on the girl, Lord Caron, his wife, daughters, and youngest son died of the chill 2 years later. Later in life, she would look back on this and be both a little sad yet relieved. Her second betrothal, and the worst in my opinion, was when she was 12 years old to Ronit Connington. As he was a landed knight, she would be quite the match for him, resulting in lands and a castle. She was promised that the man would bring her a rose, and she waited dressed in silk brocade, a quartered gown of blue and red decorated with golden suns and silver crescent moons. A gown she knew would be attractive on other girls, but not on her ungainly body. The dress and that fact had made her even more uncomfortable. However, her intended didn't like the match, and it was his father's idea. Ronit had heard of Brienne's ugliness and told his father of his displeasure with the match. His father told him all women were the same once you blew out the candle, but that wasn't enough for the boy. When he went to Tarth to see her, he wasn't any more impressed. She was tall enough to look him in the eyes, despite being 6 years younger than him, and wore a tightly laced gown with a bodice covered in garnets. He considered her a sow in silk, but noted even sows had bigger breasts. A bear's also less hairy, if you would believe him. Brienne, of course, was very aware of how she looked, and being shy, was so nervous she had bit her tongue and couldn't get the words out her septa had taught her. "Sir Ronit, I welcome you to my lord father's hall. It is good to look upon your face at last." Instead, she spat the blood from biting her tongue and maybe part of her tongue on the floor and saw his immediate disgust. He cruelly mocked her. "Brienne the Beauty, I have seen sows more beautiful than you." Connington gave her a rose, or threw it in her face as Brienne would tell it, and told her that was all she would ever have of him, and left. She would learn to hate roses after that, remembering her rejection and the mockery. Sadly, that experience would cause her to hide even more. Sure, people would mock her about the rose. The last man Brienne was betrothed to was a man named Humphrey Wagstaff. He was a proud man with a spotted head and hawk-like nose, but also quite a bit older than her at the age of 65. The day they were betrothed, he told Brienne she was expected to act like a proper woman once they were wed, telling her, "I will not have my lady wife cavorting about in man's mail. On this, you shall obey me, lest I be forced to chastise you." Brienne at this time was pretty good with a sword, and though she was still shy, she found the courage to tell the old knight that she would only accept such punishment from a man that could outfight her. Sir Humphrey, purple in anger, put on his armor to teach her a woman's proper place. They dueled with blunted tourney weapons, Brienne having a mace with no spikes, and she totally kicked his ass, breaking his collarbone, two of his ribs, and also the betrothal. Her father got the hint after that and never insisted again that she marry. And sadly, despite these betrothals, Brienne would never be courted until the events of the book. And even that was a mockery. All of this has given her a negative view of men, believing that all men wanted a soft, helpless woman that needed protection. Later in life, during the time of the books, when she went into Renly's service, she would learn to wake quickly and never sleep easily in the presence of men for fear of rape. Her first truly kind experience with men came from a Baratheon. During Renly Baratheon's coming of age tour, when Brienne was 13, he came to Tarth. Lord Tarth had welcomed him with a feast and had made Brienne attend, knowing she would hide in her room. Brienne begged her father to not make her go, afraid of laughter and that they'd all know about the rose incident. But her father forced her to attend. Renly, instead of mocking her or showing disapproval, had shown her every courtesy at the feast, treating her like she was a beautiful maid, dancing with her, and holding her in his arms as they floated gracefully across the floor. Following Renly's lead, other men begged to dance with Brienne as well. This kindness stayed with her and played a huge role in her joining Renly in the books. Likely because of his kindness and Brienne's reaction to it, at one point her father sent her to Storm's End, where she saw Renly again. It is claimed from the first moment she laid eyes on him, she fell in love with him. Though I know not super relevant, I do want to point out that even though Renly was nice to her, he said very shitty things behind her back. So that is all we know of Brienne before the show and the books. Is Brienne one of your favorite characters in the books or show? Why or why not? Let me know your thoughts on Brienne in the comment section down below. Thanks for watching. Please like, subscribe, and come back for more videos.